Let me encourage you to pull out your Bible and to turn to the book of 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy. I'll tell you that it's on page 830 in my Bible. Probably won't help you at all, but hope you'll do that. 1 Timothy chapter 1. I was reading this week and ran across a quote that just made me pause and made me kind of snicker under my breath, and then the reality of what it means really kind of sunk in a little bit. I want to share it with you. It's something that Oliver Wendell Holmes is credited as having written or said, and I tried to look it up online and couldn't find it, so I don't know if Google knows everything or not anymore now. But here's the quote. I ran across this in my reading. It said, "For there never was a pitcher that wouldn't spill, and there's always a flaw in the donkey's will." There never was a pitcher that wouldn't spill. There never was a flaw, and there's always a flaw in the donkey's will. Just thought about that a little bit this week. You know, it's kind of one of those things that, and I actually asked David, I said, "That's not a haiku. What is a haiku, David?" And no, that's not a haiku. What is that? I should have asked my wife. She probably could tell me exactly what that was. Anyway, Ann, I won't put you on the spot. What is that? I'm going to call it prose, okay? This morning, I want to talk to you for just a minute about how the Lord changed the Apostle Paul's life and heart from his own words. And that's what we're really going to look at here in 1 Timothy. The Bible actually teaches that man has a free will, okay? And that at the same time, man has a will that is determined by the Lord. So people ask, well, do I have a free will, or does God determine everything? And the answer is yes. Okay, I know that that might make some of you uncomfortable, because we like everything to fit our categories and everything to be just tight and logical. But the answer to those questions, although they seem to be contrary to one another, and they really aren't, is yes. Man, just like God, is free to do as we please. But also, just like God, what we please is determined by what we are in the totality of our being. Okay? Now, I want you to think with me about this for just a minute. And all this sprung out of that Oliver Wendell Holmes quote, "And there's always a flaw in the donkey's will." The Westminster Confession of Faith describes it this way. The Westminster Confession, it's on the slide for you there, or it should be. And at any rate, the Westminster says this: "God created man, male and female, with reasonable and immortal souls, endued with knowledge, righteousness, and true holiness after his own image, having the law of God written on their hearts, and the power to fulfill it." And here's the but statement. "And yet, under a possibility of transgressing, being left to the liberty of their will, which was subject unto change." You see, you and I were created by God with emotions, with intellect, with will, and those things are controlled by the sum total of our being, by who we are as a whole, and not the other way around, okay? Think of it like this. The course of the planets can be computed to mathematical precision so much so they do it at NASA every day, right? It's something that we can count on. The sun rises and sets. We can count on. We know what time the sun's going to come up because it's a mathematical certainty and that kind of thing. It is predictable. That happens the same way every day. But it is impossible to predict what a person may choose to do simply because we're free to do whatever we will, regardless of outward influences. You know, you can expect that someone is going to do something, and some reason, for some out of the blue, they go and do something totally different. And you can't really explain that, because every circumstance, everything that you've thought would have pointed them in that direction, and they went and flew in that direction. Maybe it's because you didn't know everything that's going on in their mind or in their heart. The will is not autonomous. It's not independent. A person can't choose to act apart from his intellect or his feelings or the condition of his soul. The choices that we make are made by our whole person. So a person may act as we please, but no matter what's going on around us, our decisions are definitely influenced by the things that are happening around us. So let me try to illustrate this. Last Tuesday was Valentine's Day, right? Okay, Valentine's Day. Big Hallmark holiday, you know. Everybody's got to buy roses. Everybody's got to buy chocolates. Everybody's got to buy cards. Everybody, you know, we got to celebrate Valentine's Day. So as you celebrated Valentine's Day, did you do this? Did you set up an atmosphere of romance and maybe fix a delicious meal for your spouse and maybe some soft romantic music and maybe, you know, dim lights and wine and chocolates? You didn't do it. But it was Valentine's Day. Okay, maybe the other side of the coin. We attempt to motivate our students. We want a learner to be in an atmosphere that is profitable for learning. We want a well-lit classroom. We want appropriate seating arrangements, you know. We don't want the talkers sitting together. We want the tall kids sitting in the back so that the little short kids can see the board and they don't have to duck around. We want everything just right. We want attractive graphics and carefully selected illustrations, and we want to teach with authority and with knowledge and communicate the truth. But having said both of those things, we can't force a lover to embrace us, nor can we coerce a pupil into paying attention, right? I mean, as a pastor, I can watch you as I preach, and I can tell when you're engaged and when you're not. Okay, got your attention, didn't I? All right. I think that if we have any hope of changing a man's will, if we have any hope of changing his heart, his nature must first be changed. You can know the truth and reject the truth, can't you? That's reality. We reject truth because we have a heart issue. There's no truth in our heart. We're broken. You know, when I talk about our free will, as the Bible talks about free will, it means that our wills are not coerced, they're not forced. We're free to do what we want to do within the limits of our ability. The will is a faculty of the soul, and it can't escape the moral character of the soul. A sinner is free to be holy, but a sinner is unable. He can't do it. You and I are always free, and we're faced with choices to refuse. A donkey does what donkeys do because it possesses a donkey's nature. That's really all about the fall. That's really about the depravity of our souls. So today, you've got an illustration before you out of the book of 1 Timothy, of a man who would have said that leading up to his encounter with Jesus Christ, he had a total donkey heart. Okay? Now, he might not have put it in those terms, but that's what I read in this portion of the Word of God this morning. We're going to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 1. I want to look specifically at the passage from verse 12 through verse 17, that long paragraph there. I want you to just take a moment, and I want you to see the magnitude of the grace of God in changing our donkey-like natures with the finished work of Jesus Christ. Let's dive into the Word, and then I'll pray. Under the inspiration of God's Holy Spirit, recorded and transmitted to us out of God's love for us and out of his love for his word, the inerrant, inspired, infallible word of God comes to us this morning in this passage. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me to his service, though formerly I was a blasphemer, persecutor, and insolent opponent. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is trustworthy and deserving full acceptance. And you need to underline these next words. That Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I receive mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost sinner, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life, to the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord will stand forever. Let's pray. Father, I ask you this morning that you would remove the scales from our eyes and that you would soften hard hearts. Lord Jesus, that those of us who have walked with you for many, many years, who have sought to love you and sought to be faithful to you, would be reminded of the beauty of the gospel once more. And Father, if there's anyone here who is yet to meet you, to know you in a saving way, I pray that you would help them to hear the words of this text. Lord Jesus, to see the example that Paul lays out before Timothy and the Ephesian church here. Father, I pray that more than anything else today, we will understand the beauty, the magnitude, the enormity of your grace in changing our hearts. Oh, Father, work grace today, I pray, in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. So this morning, our text really is loaded with what I'm going to call gospel terminology. I tried yesterday, as I was uploading my slides to PowerPoint to give you a little visual illustration of what I'm talking about here with the text. But the Proclaim app wouldn't take my text as I had highlighted and changed it. And I know you can see it perfectly from here. As you read this text, one of the things that I was hoping to point out to you on the screen is that we have a repeated pattern here that's important for you to see. As you look at the text here, you see Christ Jesus three times, and Jesus Christ is the fourth time. You see Christ four times, and then you see grace bracketed by two occurrences of mercy. And in the very center of the text, it reads, verse 15, the saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost, okay? And then Paul goes on and develops this idea. There are 11 occurrences of the first person word here, I and me, 11 times. Paul is talking to us about something that God had done in his life and his heart. He's saying, this is who I am. This is what God has done in me. It is all about the grace of God. It is all about God's mercy. And we actually have, Sharon Johnson, a chiasm here, okay? It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful way the text actually works itself out. But I wanted you to see that this morning, and I'm sorry that I couldn't make it work on the PowerPoint for you. In the text, Paul understands that in his condition outside of Christ, he was impossibly lost. He looked like someone who could never come to faith in Christ. He looked like someone who would never put his faith in the Messiah, Jesus Christ. He was a religious predator. His hands were stained with the blood of Christians. He had gone about seeking to murder. He was callous. He was self-righteous. He was a bigoted murderer, hell-bent on full force, kind of inquisition, kind of efforts. But on the Damascus Road, Saul, at that point in his life, the persecutor of the church, met the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He met Jesus Christ, and while he didn't deserve mercy, he was shown mercy. And I want you to note something here. In verse 13 and verse 16, the text, the Greek language there says, literally, he was mercied. He was mercied. I think that's important. I think we need to hear that. Paul was shown, he was mercied by Christ, by God himself. He was given mercy. The result, in Paul's own words, the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus, verse 14 of the text. Paul is describing an overwhelming flow, supply of mercy to himself. He expressed that idea later on in Romans, at the end of Romans chapter 5, when he's talking about the law. And this text links so closely to what David preached last week that you really almost ought to read them almost as one segment here. But I want you to understand that we've, just for preaching's sake, for the sake of your schedule and your endurance mentally, there's so much here. It's so rich that we just couldn't do it. We had to break this down. Paul says, the grace of the Lord overflowed for me with faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. An overwhelming supply of grace. And look at Romans 5. Now the law came in to increase the trespass. Law came so that I would understand what sin was. Okay, that's basically what he's saying there. But where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that as sin reigned in death, grace might also reign through righteousness leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The magnitude, the enormity, the overwhelming, superabundant grace of the gospel is here. This text, this paragraph, if I had to sum it up in just a phrase, says this, and I want you to get this morning. No one is beyond saving grace. No one is beyond saving grace. It's all for the glory of Christ, but no one is so bad that they can't be saved. That means you. That means me. That means there's no one who is so bad, so sinful, so rebellious, so guilty, so filled with shame and regret. There's none of us who is beyond saving grace. Hear me well. Right here in our text, 1 Timothy chapter 1, the apostle tells us that he made that discovery for himself on the Damascus Road. He felt like he was the one who was doing everything that he could do to be right with God. He encountered Jesus and he understood for the first time that he needed Christ as his Savior. You know, on that Damascus Road, he describes his himself and his former circumstances. When you leave the doors of this room today, when you go out into the world today, I want you to know for sure, I want you to go to your car understanding that no matter how huge your sin has been, no matter how bad your first personal failures might have been, I want you to know that no matter how fearful you may be that someone will know the truth about who you really are, or your addictions, or your inability to overcome those addictions, or about how deeply lonely you feel. I want you, no matter how hard you've tried to run away from God, no matter where you are, you're not beyond the reach of grace and the gospel of Jesus Christ. You are within God's reach. Grace is big enough for your sin. Listen, some of us carry secrets in our lives that make us sick. Some of us have such a load of guilt that we're neurotic. We need the gospel. Some of us are so fearful that we can't ever find a remedy. Some of us are struggling, working so hard to make ourselves better so that we work ourselves to the point where we have no peace. I'm telling you this morning, the Apostle Paul says, my testimony is I was one of those people. I lived my life that way, trying to work out my salvation, trying to be good enough for God so that I could assuage my guilt, so that I could do something about the way I felt. And until I met Christ, it was all vain effort. But grace recovered my heart grace of the gospel recovered my heart. If Paul wasn't too far gone, then neither are you. Really and truly, what Paul's doing here is he's saying, look, I'm a beggar who found bread, and I'm telling other beggars where there is bread to eat. You need this bread. Hear me well this morning. By the way, the Christian faith is not about getting better. You realize that, don't you? It's about allowing the gospel of grace to transform our hearts. Let's take this passage into our hearts by breaking it down just a little bit this morning. But let's look at the blessings Paul received. I want to just take a second, and I want you to know what the text says here. I want you to feel what Paul is saying. Paul is giving us his testimony here, and it's a beautiful thing. One of the things that I say over and over again, and you've heard me say this, is as a session, as elders, when we hear your testimonies of saving grace in Christ, when you come to join New Hope and be a part of the body here, it is one of the most wonderful, exciting, blessed times. Sessions meeting this week, for those of you who are going to meet with us, we meet at 7 o'clock. But anyway, that's an aside. That's a secondary thought to what I'm saying this morning. It is a great blessing to hear how God is continuing to grow and work in your life, but how Christ has changed your heart. It's awesome. We love it. But as I was thinking about that, we love to hear the testimony of someone like Paul who's had a dramatic conversion experience. The change in a person's life is a powerful evidence of the reality that Christ is living in your heart. But I think there are a number of dangers from those dramatic testimonies and that kind of thing that we need to be aware of. And I think we as elders know that too. I think it may be some who have been Christians but who came to Christ in a gentle, quiet way without a dramatic episode like meeting Paul on the road to Damascus. They feel like, maybe my salvation is not real. Maybe Jesus didn't really, maybe it was just something that I just thought. Maybe it just wasn't, And they can't tell those kind of exciting events like Paul talks about in his encounter with Christ. And there's also the danger that a person who's lived a relatively blameless life, who's not been a rank sinner, who wasn't a murderer like Paul, who wasn't someone pursuing the crushing of a Christian message like Paul, there's also the danger that they've lived that quiet, kind of blameless life before conversion. They might wish that they had been a drunkard or a biker who came to faith in Christ or whatever the big testimony was, lived an immoral life so that they could tell everybody a sensational story about their conversion. And that's a danger. I think we need to be careful about it. And there's a third problem. I think when a believer gives an exciting testimony, that we need to be careful that Christ is the one who increases and not us. Sometimes the story can become all about us and all about our past and that kind of thing. Listen, I had a Damascus Road experience, okay? I did. I was going in one direction and Christ literally hit me with a 2x4 and turned me around. Some of us are hard-headed that way and we need that. And that's all good. But some of you are not as rank hard heads as I am. And that's a good thing too. And he draws you sovereignly, graciously to himself. You are not beyond the reach of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Look at what Paul says about himself. Paul felt so ashamed of his former life that what did he call himself in verses 15 and 16? He says, I am the worst of sinners. I am the foremost of sinners. Paul had a dramatic encounter with Jesus. The Lord gave Paul strength. In verse 12, before he was saved, Paul thought that he was a stable, religious, good Pharisee. He assumed as a teacher of the law that he could achieve great things for God. And he was like the person who goes to church and who lives an upright and moral life, who does all the right things, who maybe even teaches Sunday school or serves as an officer or does something in the church so that he feels real good about what he's doing. But inside his heart, he knows that there is necrosis. He knows that there is deadness. There is something rotting inside his heart. Paul says that he felt like he was doing everything that he could do, and then Christ met him. And he discovered he had no strength to serve God effectively. And then I think it's amazing, beautiful, that Christ actually struck Paul blind and that he had to be led around for a little while. It takes a 2x4 for some of us. There's no doubt about it. I'm so thankful for David's sermon last week as he talked about the role of the law in our lives and in our hearts and how important the law is. After Paul became a follower of Christ, he was given the strength to do all things, okay? When Paul met Christ, he began to understand that the truth of the matter is he could do nothing that would earn the Lord's favor. He couldn't merit it. He couldn't pay it back. He couldn't begin to do anything that would merit God's grace. The Lord said to Paul over and over again, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. We can't merit grace any more than a donkey can change its own stubborn nature. In another place, Paul says, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Can't do it on his own. He can't do it in his own power, in his own ability. You can't live your life for Christ in your own power and in your own ability. It has to be the Holy Spirit working in you, giving you grace day after day after day. Secondly, Jesus Christ considered Paul to be faithful. He had been given a work to do for the Lord, and Paul got with it. Okay? Now, so what am I saying? It means that Paul says, look, I can't do this in my own ability, but I'm going to do this in the Lord's strength, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to get after it. I'm going to pursue it. I'm going to do it to the best that I can. And thirdly, Christ appointed Paul to service. He was appointed by the apostle Christ, Jesus Christ himself. It was what Christ did in him that made Paul into who he was. Paul was a great missionary. But it wasn't that Paul in himself was a great missionary. It was Christ living out through Paul that he became a great missionary. It's that dependence. You know, Paul wasn't one of the original 12 disciples who accompanied Jesus throughout his earthly ministry. And in fact, during the time that Jesus' earthly ministry was going, he was preaching and performing miracles. Jesus was performing miracles. Paul was living as a strict Pharisee. Paul was living a life so that he could earn merit with God. He was trying to earn it. He was trying to merit it in some way. And he went around destroying those who were part of the way. Paul needed that 2x4 just like I did. At his conversion, Paul was given strength. He was given ability. He was a trustworthy servant. He was serving. It was all out of the grace of God. And Paul would, for the rest of his entire life, live to please God in response to God's initiating love. I want to take a second and think about that for just a minute, if I can. Just ask you to think with me for a minute. Did Paul's call to serve God make Paul behave in a proud way? God's called me to be an apostle. You know, hey, I got grafted in at the last minute, but I'm one of them. I'm part of the team. It's all good. Did that happen in Paul's heart? That's not at all what happened in Paul's. Paul found himself utterly dependent on Jesus Christ for everything that he did. But he served. He gave himself. He poured himself out as a servant. Actually, he uses a word that we translate deacon here in this text, okay? He gave himself as a deacon. He served in humility. He was a servant. He was a slave of Jesus Christ. He calls himself that in Philippians chapter 1, verse 1. He had a lowly attitude like the psalmist who said, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. We ought to be glad to do whatever the Lord calls us to do because we love Jesus so, so, so very much for what he's done for us. Our response to the love that we've received is to give ourselves to him, to serve him. How do you do it? How do you live your life out that way? Well, you know, the first thing that came to mind was tomorrow's dumpster day, but, and I'm not plugging that. I mean, well, yes, I am. But I think that's a great way to serve. I think you can serve in the kitchen. I think you can serve folding tables. I think you can fold moving chairs. I think we can serve as we teach, as deacons carry out their task of ministering to the body of Christ. I think we serve as elders who lead and who oversee the work of the church and who seek to promote the gospel in beautiful ways. I think we serve as we teach in the classroom. Lindsay needs help in the children's ministry. I think we serve in those ways. We need to fill those roles, and we don't do it because the preacher made us feel bad that we hadn't done it. We do it because Christ has changed our hearts, and we want to show our gratitude to him for the great grace that we've received. Our motivation is what drives us to serve. Our motivation is that we love Jesus. Our natures have been changed. Our donkey-like wills have been transformed. We want to give of ourselves. When you think about your life before Jesus redeemed you, do you think like Paul did concerning the awfulness of your past life before Christ? Occasionally, I will sit down and spend a few minutes thinking about what my life was like before I came to Christ. And given the snapshot of what my life was like before Christ, wondering, at this point in my life, where would I be? Okay? Think about it for just a minute. That's almost as much fun as going to see your retirement benefits and looking at the life actuary tables and realizing that you're going to probably live long enough to outlive your money, but your life is going to be over. It's, you know, it doesn't give you a real sense of confidence about things, does it? Look back at your life before Christ. Think about what it would be if you had been allowed to stay there. That's a picture that ought to give you a snapshot of what kind of grace you have received from God. That ought to teach you something about what God has done for you. God is so unlike you and me. Paul looked at himself and he called himself, he called himself a blasphemer of God. He said, I've been saved even though I was a blasphemer. A blasphemer is one who shows disrespect for God. And that's who every one of us in that BC, before Christ time, is a blasphemer against God. But look at that word. I love the word mercy. Mercy, like grace, is something that's not deserved. When God shows mercy to someone, he displays his divine pity and compassion toward that person. Why was it that God showed mercy to Paul? It doesn't seem right, does it? I mean, here's Paul. He's opposed to God in every way. He's doing everything he can to thwart what God is doing as Messiah has come. But God showed mercy to Paul solely, only for the only reason that God had set his love on Paul before the foundation of the world. God loved Paul before Paul ever came into being. God set his love on him. None of us who belong to the Lord are Christians just because you made a decision to follow Christ. Okay? Hear me well. Oh, you have to decide to follow Christ, but you are not a believer because you decided. We're believers because God has chosen us before the foundation of the world, Ephesians 1:4. Before the world was created, he chose us. That's the amazing thing about God's love. He shows mercy to the most unlikely people. Jack Miller used to say, you're worse than you thought you were, but you're more loved than you ever dared imagine. That is so true. We don't realize the depth of our depravity. Well, I want to close this morning. I want to draw the text to a conclusion this morning with kind of an illustration. We talk about the work of Christ on the cross to redeem us. We talk about what Jesus has done to change our hearts like he did in Paul's heart where Paul met Jesus on the Damascus Road. And we think about the cross. We celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, and we celebrate what Christ has done, taking our sin upon himself and everything that that means. So when we have communion, when we think about the cross, we need to do more than just remember what Jesus has done, okay? We need to do more than just embrace the truth of a historical event. We need to take that historical event, and even though it's true and certain, we need to know so much more about it. So let me illustrate what I'm trying to get at this way. In 49 BC, before Jesus was born, Julius Caesar crossed a small river with a small legion of men. The name of the river was the Rubicon. Okay? You've heard crossing the Rubicon. You've heard that before. It marked the boundary that was between Italy and Gaul, between Italy and France, more or less, okay? It was a historical event. It took place in history. It's really not that big a deal, in all honesty, because the Rubicon had been crossed hundreds of times by bunches of people. It wasn't any big deal that Julius Caesar crossed the Rubicon. It's not a big river, been crossed before. But that seemingly unimportant event had a deeper meaning. The Rubicon marked a national border, okay? A frontier. And by crossing the Rubicon, what Caesar was doing was he was declaring war on Pompey and on the Roman Senate. And he had monumental results. The event was the crossing. The meaning of that event was the declaration of war. In some ways, Jesus' death represents the crossing of the Rubicon. Jesus wasn't the first person to die on the cross, was he? We know that the Romans used the cross as a means of executing criminals all the time. Many people had died unjustly. Just like Jesus did. Many people had given their lives even in exchange for others, just like Jesus did. But Jesus' death was different from all the rest. Why? Why was it different? Why did Jesus die? Why did Jesus let mankind kill him? Why? The answer is that he's the second Adam. He came and did what the first Adam failed to do. He lived a perfect, sinless life, and he endured the wrath of God for sin, even though he was without sin. Listen to me. What we're talking about here is called the Great Exchange, okay? It's called the fact that
Jesus, the righteous one, suffers from the for the unrighteous. It's called imputation. Fancy word, okay? It's just the great exchange. Jesus took upon himself your sin, even though he was completely sinless and completely blameless. He bore your penalty on the cross, in the cross, in his body, in every way. He took the wrath of God for you. He suffered your penalty. He took your death. He was executed to pay for your sin, your guilt, your shame, your rebellion, your unfaithfulness, your fear. He died in your place. He took God's scorn. He took separation from the Heavenly Father that he had never endured before. That's why he cried out from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? God turned his back on his son because his son had taken on our unrighteousness. He was no longer holy in and of himself. He became your substitute. He paid your debt. You know, not only did Jesus take himself, your sin upon himself, he also gives you his righteousness. And that's important for you to understand. Actually, I had the word imputation on the slide there. Probably should have changed that to double imputation. You know why? Because not only did he take your sin, but he gave us his righteousness. Jesus gets your sin, you get his righteousness. The gospel that Paul tells us about is because Jesus has done that for you and for me. He took what was yours. He took what you deserved. And Jesus' death doesn't simply just get you back to zero. You know, if Jesus' death on your behalf just got you back to zero, then it would be up to you to decide whether you ended up spending eternity in heaven or in hell, either living in the blessedness of heaven or living under the wrath of God in hell, if it just brought us back to zero. Because if it just brought us back to zero, then Jesus would have just died in your place. But he gave you his righteousness. He gave you something that you couldn't earn, you couldn't merit for yourself, that Paul says, I couldn't earn for myself. I couldn't take it upon myself to do. There's not a single aspect of your life that ought to be untouched by that truth. Think about your conscience. What do you do with a guilty conscience? What do you do when your conscience is feeling that way? If you have a pulse, you have some sense of guilt. I know it. If you're breathing, you feel those things, okay? Most people deal with their guilt in two ways, one of two ways usually. Some listen to what culture says, and culture in our world says, hey, there's no right, there's no wrong. You just do whatever feels right to you. You do you, you know? It'll be all right. As long as you don't hurt anybody else, it's okay. You know, there was that whole I'm okay, you okay thing back in the 60s, 70s. When was that? You know, we live in a relativistic society. And you just remind yourself that it's okay. Then there are other people who say, well, you just have to make up for your wrong, you know, by trying harder next time. You can work your way out of that guilty conscience. Just don't do that again. Just make a promise to yourself and make a promise to God, whoever your God may be, that you're not going to do that anymore. And you're going to try harder. And you're going to keep trying. Hey, if you've tried one of those solutions, you can tell, I don't have to tell you, you can tell me. The guilt keeps coming back, doesn't it? The shame keeps coming back. You can't get rid of it because it's not going to satisfy. It's not going to assuage your guilt. It's not going to get rid of it. Maybe you have a guilty conscience right now, and sometimes we try to deal with it. There's another way to deal with it, by the way. We can point at other people. Hey, I'm not as bad as they are. You know, at some point you get to the point where you're going, I'm not as bad as Hitler was. What do? We become blame shifters, we become fault finders, we become finger pointers. We try to distract the attention from our sin by pointing to everybody else's sin. And some of us are paralyzed by our shame. We think we're so bad, we don't even believe God could ever forgive us, let alone use us. And that's Satan whispering in your ear.
I love Martin Luther. Luther was one of those people who often spoke clearly about what he thought, sometimes with a little brash language here and there and that kind of thing. Luther often wrote and spoke about how Satan would come and whisper in his ear, accusing him of all kinds of filthy sin. He would say things like this, and these are Luther's own words. He said Satan would come to him and say, "Martin, you're a liar, greedy, lecherous, you're a blasphemer, a hypocrite, you cannot stand before God." And Luther records that he would respond with the gospel to those accusations. He didn't deny that he was a sinner or he didn't try to promise that he would try to get his act together. He didn't try to make up for his sin. Instead, he went to the gospel, and here's how he responded. These are Luther's words. Satan has accused him. "Well, yes, I am. And indeed, Satan, you do not know the half of it. I've done much worse than that. If you were to care to give me your full list, I can no doubt add to it and help make it up more complete. But you know what? My Savior has died for all my sins. Those you mention, those I could add, and indeed those I've committed, but I'm so wicked that I am unaware of having done so. It does not change the fact that Christ has died for all of them. His blood is sufficient, and on the day of judgment, I shall be exonerated because he has taken all my sins upon himself and clothed me with his own perfect righteousness." That's how you deal with guilt. That's how you deal with the wicked things that Satan brings and whispers in your ears. You use the gospel in your life every day. You let the gospel handle that donkey-like nature that lives in every one of us. You battle your guilt, your shame, you silence the accuser's whispers, and you defeat your sinful nature's attempts. Satan wants to leave you. The Doors used a phrase in one of their songs, like a squirming toad. You have that picture? That's the way Satan wants you to be. Satan wants to leave you as a squirming toad in your rebellion against the God of all grace. And you need to speak back to Satan with the realities of the great exchange having taken place in your life. It wouldn't be right, it wouldn't be proper for me to close this morning without asking you a direct question. Have you participated? Have you had that great exchange take place in your heart and life? Have you dealt with your sin? Have you trusted Christ alone for salvation as he's offered in the gospel? You can have the freedom that the Apostle Paul had. You can have the freedom that I've learned about. You can have the freedom that Martin Luther speaks back to Satan with when he accuses, by making that great exchange, letting it be a part of your life. If you've never trusted Christ, I urge you, today is the day. Do it today. If you need to talk to someone, any one of the pastors here, me, David, Matt, we'd be happy to talk to you. Our elders will be glad to talk to you about what it means to know and love and serve Christ. So I offer you this morning the gospel. It is the only thing that changes the will to pursue God and to pursue righteousness.